So, how is your practice going? Any difficulties? Why do we come here to this place? Why do we stay here? We come here to practice. We come here to practice the path of the Lord Buddha, the path that leads to the freedom from dukkha. And the path that leads to the freedom from dukkha involves a lot of dukkha. A lot of dissatisfaction, a lot of difficulties, a lot of... overcoming laziness, overcoming boredom, overcoming difficulties, overcoming pain, investigating pain. Yeah? I mean, what did I say last time? I mean, if you want to overcome dukkha, you know, we have to go through the fires of dukkha. If you want to overcome hell, we have to go through the fires of hell. Yes, sorry, there is no other way. Yeah? Why do we have to go through the fires of hell? You have to understand the experience of hell, yeah? You have to understand the experience of dukkha in order to be able to overcome it, to see what is behind dukkha, to see what is behind hell. That's why we have to go through the fires. Yeah? Otherwise, we just stay here and nothing will change, except that we have some happy moments when we go into samadhi. That's it. Yeah, when we come out of samadhi, we have difficulties. Or sometimes we even have difficulties, you know, getting into samadhi because the mind doesn't want to concentrate. It wants to play around here and there. The path that leads to the end of dukkha, yeah, I mean, that is the fourth noble truth. The first noble truth is dukkha, dissatisfaction. We have dissatisfaction, we have boredom, we are restless. Yeah, this is dukkha. Yeah? We have pain, we suffer. Yeah, some of us suffer. Yeah, other people, you know, just have, you know, discontent in their daily life. And that is probably most of us, you know, I mean, came here because of dukkha. Yeah? Because of dissatisfaction, because they see life is not the way they thought it will, or that they thought it will be. They see, you know, all the difficulties, you know, the world, you know, brings to us. And the little contentment that we have in the world. Sometimes, we get some contentment here or there. Contentment through our work, contentment through our marriage, contentment through our children, and so on. Yeah, but there is a lot of discontent as well. When we think about content and discontent, you know, I mean, they're just the the same as a coin. Yeah, a coin has a head and a tail. Yeah, I mean, if there's no head, there's no tail. Yeah, if there's no contentment, you know, there's no discontentment. That's why the Nibbana is actually called the supreme happiness. You know, it stands beyond contentment and discontentment, or happiness and unhappiness. It depends on how you want to phrase it. So we have to understand dukkha. Yeah? We have to see really dukkha. Yeah? We have to see for what it is. Yeah? This constant dissatisfaction that constantly creeps up in our mind. Yeah? And this dissatisfaction can come through thoughts, that come through memories, that come through doubt, you know. Doubt, you know, who are we, why are we, and so on. Yeah? Why is it not working out the way, you know, These are the things, you know, we ask ourselves in daily life. The answer to it is, because we want something. That's the second noble truth. We want this to happen or we want that to happen. We want to be like this or we want to be like that. Or we don't want to be like this or we don't want to be like that. Or we don't want to be at all or we want to be. We want, some of us, you know, want to be in heaven, yeah? And other people, you know, I mean, they're just contented, you know, being a human being with all what it brings. In this life, we are human beings, yeah? And we have a body that makes us a human being, yeah? There are 31 realms of existence. And we are on the fifth level, you know, below us, there are the animal realms, there are the ghost realms, and there are the demon realms and the hell realms. Yeah? So we are stuck at the fifth level, you know, above us, you know, there are whatever, 25 or whatever, 25 heavenly realms, yeah? If I counted correctly, I thought so. Something like that. And when we are born into a human life, you know, I mean, we have a body, yeah? And this body, yeah, gives us a lot of trouble. We have to constantly look after this body. Yeah? The first 15 years or the first 16 years of our life, we have to program it. Yeah? We have to program it. You know, when it comes out of the womb, this body doesn't know how to do anything at all. Yeah? It doesn't even know how to digest. So we have to train it to digest. Then we have to train to move, you know. I mean, moving the hands, moving the legs, you know, then we have to learn to walk, then we have to learn to talk, then we have to learn to think, then we have to learn to write and to read, yeah? All these things. Yeah? We go to school, how many years of our life do we go to school? Learn all sorts of things and realize, you know, in the end that everything that we learned in school or most of the things we learned in school are not really very helpful during our life. But we have to go through it. Yeah? Some jobs, you know, require, you know, that we get schooling. Yeah? And when we are 16 or 20, you know, when we go to university, and maybe 24, we are finished with educating this body. 20 years or 16 years, 16 to 20 years, you know, it takes us to train this body. Huh? Remember this? Huh? Go back. If you don't remember it, you don't want to remember it. Huh? Even now, when we get older, we only think about the time when we were 18 or 20, yeah? Because it was much nicer. We don't want to remember the times when we went through puberty, yeah? Oh, do you want to remember these fires in our heart, you know, that burned us out? The sexual craving that burned us out, and so on. Yeah? You want to go through it again? If you don't do anything, you will. Yeah? You will, you know, in your next life as a human being, you will go through the same difficulties. Yeah? You will go through the training of walking, of talking, of thinking, learning to think, you know, and then growing up, yeah? And then you have this body, you know, that is fine for 30 or 35 years, you know, and then it starts to decay. Yeah? It starts to fall apart, just like a car. Hmm? After a certain amount of time, the car starts to fall apart. And we have to replace parts, you know, we have to fix parts, just like with our body. Yeah? Our repair shop, you know, we call it doctor or hospital. Yeah? That's where we repair the body. So, I mean, see the body as it is, you know, it's a body, yeah? Huh? Just like we see our car as it is, it's just a car. It's there, you know, for bringing us here and bringing us there and giving us some comfort, yeah, in traveling. And that's the same with the body, yeah? It's there, you know, for going here and going there, for doing this and for doing that, yeah? But it is not us, it's not me, it's not mine, it doesn't belong to me. We just happen to be born in the body, you know, and we just happen to die in the body, and we believe, because we don't know any other truth, we believe we are the body. We are not the body. Just get out of the body and look at the body and see that you are not the body. The citta and the body are two different things. If you remember correctly, you know, in the in the suttas it says, you know, we have five khandhas, yeah? Five groups, you know, that make us, yeah? The groups are the body, yeah? Feeling, yeah? Feeling are bodily feelings and mental feelings. Then what is it else? You know, it's thoughts and memory and association and consciousness. These are the five groups that make us. There's nothing outside of these groups that we consider to be ourselves. Huh? When you think about your personality, huh? When you think about I am like this, yeah? What is it? What does it mean? It's a view, it's an opinion. A view and opinion is a... It's a combination of thoughts and memories, yeah? Oh, my character, yeah, what is this, yeah? What is my character? I mean, it's also made out of these five groups. It's made of thoughts, yeah? I mean, before any action comes a thought. No? So it's made out of thoughts, you know, before we say something, you know, there is a thought coming, I want to say this, yeah? Before we do something, there's a thought coming, I want to get up, yeah? And then we get up. Or I want to do this, or I want to do that. There's always a thought coming before it. How the thought is triggered, I mean, that is for us to investigate. Maybe it is triggered through a feeling, maybe it is triggered through a memory, maybe it is triggered through a thought alone, yeah? But that is how we are, yeah? Our character, you know, the tendency that this thought or that thought comes in often, yeah, is the tendency of the mind is created by karma from previous lives. Yeah? And it's also thought. Yeah? So we see this thought, you know, say there's a thought, you know, and let it go. Yeah? We see this memory and say, ah, there's a memory and let it go. Because it doesn't belong to us. Yeah? Just like the body does not belong to us. Maybe the body is easier to understand that it doesn't belong to us. But feeling it is more difficult to understand. I feel this, you know. We constantly, when we are in the world, we constantly refer to ourselves as feeling this or feeling that. I'm happy or I'm happy. Yeah? I'm like this or I'm like that, you know. I mean, it is very much, you know, we are very much attached to the feeling, yeah. Not only the bodily feeling, but also the mental feeling. We define ourselves as a happy person, as a depressed person, you know, as a suicidal person, yeah. What is it, yeah? It's the tendencies of our character that we, you know, that we build up over lives and lives and lives, yeah. That's it, you know, and then we see it, you know, we see for what it is, yeah. Tendencies it's a composition, you know, of thoughts, memories and feelings. Yeah? They all come together. When you have, you know, when you go back, you know, go back into when you were 15 or 12 or 8, you know, and then go back into a memory about the time, you know, and there instantly pops up a feeling as well. And then comes a thought, yeah, as well, yeah? And that increases the feeling, and then comes another memory, you know, of a similar time, and increases the feeling, and then we get into a mood, into a certain mood, either be it happy mood or, you know, be it unhappy mood, yeah? Oh, my life was so difficult, you know, I mean, my parents were so strict, and so on, and so on, and so on. That's a personality, you know, but As we know, you know, I mean, we have grown up, you know, we are old enough, you know, we know personalities can change, yeah? Our character tendencies can change, yeah? We see that one character tendency, you know, we saw it maybe in this life, that a character tendency is not, you know, doesn't bring wholesome effect, so we try to mend it. So we changed our behavior, or we changed our programming, because our personality is nothing else than a huge program, yeah? A huge program of conditions, yeah? When this condition, you know, happens, then I will react like this. When that condition happens, I will react like this. When this happens, you know, when I see my father, I become a little boy. Or when I see my mother, I become a little boy. When I see my when I see my teacher, I will be like that, you know? Most of you, you know, when you see your teacher, you become afraid. or other things. Yeah? And when I see my girlfriend, you know, I will be happy, you know, or I will be unhappy, you know, it depends on, you know, sometimes we are happy and sometimes we are unhappy, yeah? Sometimes we see her, yeah, or see the girlfriend and we become very happy that we see her, and the next time, you know, we are contradicting ourselves constantly, and the next time we are unhappy, you know, because, yeah, we don't feel well, huh? Remember that, huh? Yeah? There is nothing constant, yeah? That brings us back, you know, to the three universal characteristics of this universe. Anicca, everything is changing. Our thoughts are changing, our memories are changing, our feelings are changing. Yeah? So, who are we? Yeah, one moment we are happy, the next moment we are unhappy, then the next moment we are depressed, and so on. It constantly changes. So who are you? Yeah? Are you a happy person, unhappy person, dissatisfied person, and so on? Yeah? We define ourselves with these things. We define ourselves with these feelings that come up, yeah? Or the memories that come up. But your memories also change over time. Yeah? When you were 12, you had different memories than you have now, and so on. Yeah? And the thoughts are changing. Yeah? Yeah? Maybe, you know, When I was 18, you know, I was more communist, you know, and then, you know, I mean, then my thoughts changed. Maybe this wasn't a good idea, you know, and I became more like a humanist and so on. Yeah? And then I came to Buddhism. So, I mean, who are we? Huh? I mean, just because things appear in front of our eyes, when we close our eyes, that's not who we are. That's the things that appear in front of our eyes. And I mention it often, yeah? I mean, remember the times when you went to a movie, you know, it was an interesting movie, it was either a horror movie or a comedy, you know, or science fiction or things like that. You identified with the people or with the beings. Actually, there were no beings on the screen because they were two-dimensional, they were just colors, yeah? And you identified with these people, you know, I mean, you cheered for this person, you know, and you hated that person, and you hated the action, or you loved the action, and so on. Yeah? It's nothing different. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't matter if it is on the outer screen and hundreds of people are watching it, or if you close your eyes and it is on the inner screen. There is something happening. Yeah. And what is happening, you know, memories come up, feelings come up, and so on, yeah? pictures are coming up, yeah? These are also, you know, these are also memories, yeah? Or thoughts, visual thoughts. They come up, yeah? And they stay there for a while and then they go away, yeah? And one leads to the other, yeah? It's just like an endless clock, you know? I mean, that doesn't need any battery or doesn't need any weights. It's ticking and ticking and ticking, yeah? And one thing leads to another. A memory leads to a thought. A thought leads to a feeling. A feeling leads to a memory or a thought, and so on. It's running around. Huh? One of the gears, you know, gets hold and catches the other gear, and this is moving, and then this gear, you know, the gear of feeling is moving the memory, and so on. Yeah? I mean, remember, you know, when you observed a watch, you know, when you opened a watch, you know, and then you see, you know, what is in there? There's no time, yeah? There's just the gears running around, yeah? One, you know, one going into the other and moving the other, yeah? One is going faster and the other is going slower. Yeah? It's the same thing. Yeah? Thoughts are going faster, you know, feelings going faster, you know, consciousness going the fastest. Yeah? And consciousness is actually, you know, the gear that runs the fastest. Yeah? And we can't catch it, you know, because it's so fast. Yeah? We think it doesn't move. Yeah? At a certain frequency, you know, we think things are standing still or are constantly there. And that is with the consciousness. It's moving so fast that we can't see that it is moving. But it triggers all the other things. It triggers memory. Most of the time it triggers memory or it triggers thought. What came into the sense contact? And so on. So who are you? Ask yourself, who are you? I was one, you know, a year ago or 10 years ago, or when you came, yeah, before you ordained, yeah, I was very enthusiastic, you know, I mean, about ordaining, and then I wanted to practice, very hard, and then suddenly, so difficult. What is difficult? Sometimes, you know, we come across in our practice, you know, about this immense difficulty, you know, and it seems like, you know, a big mountain that we can't cross or that is too difficult to cross, yeah? And we always avoid, you know, to climb it, or to go through it, yeah? So we run around and look for the easy way out, but, you know, after a while, maybe only after years or maybe after 10 years, we realize, I mean, all our time, you know, all our time being a bhikkhu or practitioner, we run around this mountain. And then we make a determination, okay, now we tackle this problem. Yeah, and the moment we made this determination to tackle the problem, the mountain itself, you know, becomes a, you know, curtain of light. You just walk through it. There wasn't actually any problem, Anybody had this experience? Happened quite often to me. This is so difficult. I can't tackle it. Yeah. And then I determined, what the hell? And then suddenly the problem disappeared, because it is just the problem is just a combination of thoughts and memories. Yeah? That's it. Yeah? If there is no thought, there is no problem. Yeah? I mean, and we experience that in meditation. We experience that in samatha. There is no problems. There is no discontent. Yeah? I mean, if you go into upachara samadhi where there are no thoughts and no memories, yeah, first of all, there is no past, there is no future, yeah, and there are no problems, there is no loneliness, there is nothing of these thoughts that we constantly have when we come back, you know, from upachara samadhi and go back into the world of the senses. In the world of senses, there is constantly these things, yeah. There's these problems, yeah, tomorrow, I mean, yeah. We constantly think about the future, tomorrow, what do I eat tomorrow, what do I do tomorrow, how do I earn my money, and so on, yeah. And then we reflect about the past, you know, and most of us, you know, reflect, oh, it was so much easier 2 years ago or 5 years ago, yeah. But when we go into upachara samadhi, I mean, the past and the future have gone, yeah. There is no past, there is no future, there is no problem, there is no loneliness, there is no fear, yeah? There is nothing, there is just, you know, either stillness or contentment or happiness, yeah, or joy or whatever, yeah? That's it, yeah? Then we come out of upachara samadhi and the whole world builds up, yeah? All our problems, oh, now I have to do this, now I have to do that, yeah? These problems, Get this clear, these problems exist only in our mind. Huh? And it's a thought and it's a combination of thought and together with memories and feelings, you know, that create this problem. Huh? Because actually there is no problem. Huh? We created this problem and then what did we do when we create this problem? We think about how to solve it. what a waste of time. Yeah? If we don't think there's no problem, we don't need to solve anything. Yeah? If we need to do something, then we know we need to do something. But for that, we need, of course, a lot of sati. We need to see what is the situation and the moment. You know, in each situation, there are lots of opportunities. But because of our thought process, you know, we don't see all these opportunities and depending on our thinking, depending on our character, most of the time we take the wrong decision, yeah? And that leads, you know, to another difficulty and to another difficulty. But, I mean, if we see a problem, we say, there's a problem, let's do putu, 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 and see if the problem persists, yeah? And then we get into upachara, and then we see there's no problem, and then we come out, you know, and the thought starts again, you know, oh, this problem. Huh? Well, yeah, it wasn't there before, huh? And we don't see how we create it, yeah? And the moment we create it, you know, just like I said before, you know, we try to solve it. How can you solve it with thoughts? Yeah? Yeah? The only way, you know, to solve anything is by action. Yeah? Be it bodily action, be it, you know, be it by speech, or be it by mental action, you know. How can you solve a problem? Yeah? Buddha, 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 Buddha. Yeah? Put the attention and the problem is gone. Yeah? Yeah? Then the thoughts and the memories come back, you know, and then the problem starts arising again. Yeah? You see, it is not, you know, it's not real. Yeah? And this is something that we really have to realize, and this principle of anatta, we really have to cherish and develop it. There is a feeling, okay, let's have a look at the feeling. Okay, it's a painful feeling, or it's and there's a pleasant feeling, and there's a neutral feeling. That's it. Yeah. So go on. Yeah. There's a thought. It's not my thought. Yeah. I think like this, I want this, you know, there's wanting, there's this, and there's that, yeah? And then we can look at it and say, maybe, I don't know, if I do this, maybe I get happy, maybe I don't get happy, but because I don't know the results, okay, let's go ahead and do it with sati. Yeah? When we have sati, you know, I mean, we do, why are we doing it, yeah? And then we do it, you know, observe our doing it, you know, see all the troubles, all the difficulties that are involved in doing it, and then let's look at the result. Yeah? This is, you know, what makes us human, yeah? Being able to reflect about one's action. Yeah? And not only action, but also to reflect upon our speech, yeah? What we do, or reflecting about our thought process. That's what makes us human, Homo sapiens. Yeah? Remember that? Homo sapiens, we all call ourselves a Homo sapiens, but we are nothing else than sophisticated robots, yeah? Programmed. Yeah? And if you remember what I said before, I mean, when we start coming into this body or when we are born into this world, we start to program this robot. Yeah? And that's how it is, yeah? And then we constantly refine it over our life, yeah? Hopefully to the better, yeah? But some people, you know, don't take the opportunity to develop it or condition it to the better or program it to the better, but, you know, actually become worse and worse and worse. Huh? It's not me, it's not mine, it's not myself, you know. Huh? It's programmed, yeah? It's conditioned, yeah? You remember conditioning, huh? You remember what the Lord Buddha talked about, the Nibbana? The unconditioned, where there is no condition existing. That's why we are free. Yeah? The moment there is a conditioning, yeah, if I see this or if I see that, then I do this or then I do that. And if you remember, you know, your life or parts of your life, you see that sometimes you changed, yeah, your programming. Yeah? You said, I don't want to react like this when I see this person, yeah? I want to be more kind to this person, yeah? And then over the time, we become more kind. But then, you know, I mean, it's also programming. It's not free. We cannot react in a free way, you know, where we see actually what is going on and what is needed. Hmm? Yeah. Ah, when I came to Wat Babantat, yeah, I mean... And the practice was not easy. Yeah? It was rather difficult. Yeah? I mean, especially practicing this a super practice. Yeah? And then constantly, you know, constantly the scolding of Thanacha Mahabua. Yeah? And I thought to myself, why is he not encouraging me to practice? Why is always, you know, why is always stepping on my toes? Why is never, you know? Huh? Why is he not encouraging me to practice, yeah? I mean, he encouraged me to... I had an idea about what is encouragement. Oh, you're good, you know, I mean, just go on, you know, I mean, that is what I wanted, yeah? I wanted recognition from my teacher, yeah? I wanted, you know, be patted on my back and said, yes, you're good, you're great, you can do it, yeah? And he didn't give me any of this, huh? He only scolded me when I was doing something wrong. Hmm? He only got on my kilesas, you know, and showed me, yeah, it's another way of encouraging me. See, yeah, there's still a thorn in your arm, you know, that hurts whenever I touch it, huh? Don't you want to remove it, huh? This is the encouragement that he gave. Not the encouragement, oh, you're good, you can do it, you can do it. Ah, you're such a good person. Yeah? That just feeds the ego. Huh? And, you know, a lot of teachers I had before, you know, fed my ego. Yeah, and it was becoming bigger and bigger and bigger, you know. So that I couldn't walk through the door anymore. Yeah, because my ego was so big. Yeah. And then, yeah, I mean, Lungta Mahabodh saw it, you know. I mean, he never encouraged, you know. I mean, he hardly encouraged, yeah. Only if, you know, if it was really, you know, you really attained to something, then he smiled, yeah. Otherwise, you know, he was just, you know, very stern, yeah. Constantly scolding, yeah. But if you did nothing wrong, he didn't scold you, yeah. But he also didn't smile, yeah. Because that is what he expected, yeah. So, I mean, if you expect the teacher, you know, to pat us on the back and say, yes, oh, you poor guy, you can do it, yeah, just do a little bit of more practice. You have to find your own encouragement. And when you see and remember, you know, when we came here, we came because of dukkha, yeah, we wanted to overcome dukkha. So the best thing a teacher can do is, you know, to show you the dukkha, to step on your toes constantly, yeah, it hurts, yeah? Because normally our life, you know, is there's so little dukkha in our life, you know? And so if nobody steps on our toes, we don't realize, and we think, you know, there's no more dukkha in our life, yeah? So that is the best thing a teacher can do, yeah? Show us, you see, there's still dukkha, yeah? There's still a lot of thorns in your arm, you know? I mean, whenever I touch it, you know, there's some poisonous going into your heart and you get angry, huh? Yeah, then you shouldn't get angry at your teacher. You should be grateful that he points out, yeah, the faults, yeah, or points out the wrongdoing. Yeah? I mean, what is the description? Yeah? What did the Lord Buddha say about? Yeah, I mean, he said, what is a spiritual friend? Yeah, Kalayanamitta, a spiritual friend. I mean, in the West, we always think, you know, it's a friend, yeah, that encourages you, pats you on the back, yeah, but never says anything bad about you. Yeah? That is a friend that we like, yeah? Or that is a teacher that we like, yeah? Yeah? Who is soft, who is smiling all the time, you know, and never scolds us, yeah? That what we think is a Kalayanamitta. But a Kalayanamitta, I mean, if you remember, you know, if you had really good friends, you know, they pointed out and said, hey, look, you know, what you just did, you know, was really cross, yeah? Was really bad, huh? I mean, other people cannot talk to us like that because we instantly defend ourselves, yeah? And say, who are you, you know? Huh? But if it is a really a good friend, I mean, we are much more able to listen, yeah? So our teacher is a Kalayanamitta, is a good friend. So don't expect, you know, don't expect any encouragement, yeah? Except for the encouragement to show you the faults, yeah? And I don't attack you personally, huh? I attack your kilesas that get overhand or out of hand, yeah? These I attack constantly, yeah? And when I attack them and call these kilesas stupid, then they are stupid. Of course the kilesas are stupid. But that doesn't mean that we, you know, as a person who comes here, you know, and tries to correct himself, is stupid. Huh? You have to distinguish between these things. Huh? Even if I call you stupid, you know, I mean, the action that you did was stupid. Huh? It's not the person, you know, who is stupid. You understand that, huh? This is the way, yeah? I mean, as I said, you know, it took me years to understand that, yeah? That the encouragement of Thanacha Mahabodh was actually his scolding, yeah? I mean, if he stopped scolding a monk, that means he has given up on him. Yeah? Remember that? Huh? I think I said that before. I mean, he gave up on quite a few monks, yeah. He wasn't even interested in what they were doing. He didn't scold them anymore because he saw it's useless, yeah. But if he saw, somebody reacted to his stepping on his toes, then he continued, because he see, this guy, is really interested in practice. He's trying to learn how to deal with these situations, these painful situations. Yeah? Get it? Understand it? So don't get disheartened, when I constantly scold you. Yeah. See it as an encouragement. Oh, thank you that you showed me, where I was lacking. And that's why we are here. We want somebody. We don't want all to be, I'm good, I'm also good, don't say anything bad about me. Yeah. Because that just feeds our ego. We want to see, where we are wrong. And we go so easily wrong because, the kilesas, they just want to play around, They don't pay the bill, yeah? They just suggest to us something, and then we do it, and then we pay the bill, yeah? If we go against the five precepts, we go to hell for a while, yeah? If we do something good, then we go to heaven. It's not the kilesas who go to heaven. It's not the kilesas who go to hell. It's we who experience the hell of our bad doings, or we experience the heaven of our good doing. Yeah? The kilesas are there just suggesting this. They're just, want to play around. Yeah, constantly feeding us with their ideas and say, you should do this, or you should become like this, or you should become like that. Yeah? No, we don't. We should become like this or like that. Yeah, we should be free of all this conditioning. Yeah, becoming like this or becoming like that is conditioning. Yeah, we should be free of this conditioning. Yeah? And that is what we have to investigate. When we see something coming up, there's a feeling and then there's a memory. And if we have enough sati, we see how these feelings and memories arise. Yeah, what is the real cause? What is the stone that created this avalanche? That is what we have to see. But for this, we have to train sati. And how do we train sati? We train sati with going into samadhi, into upachara samadhi, And this is something we really need to develop, yeah, where thoughts and memories really stop and when we are really free for a moment of time. Yeah? And hopefully, longer than 20 minutes, hopefully, for 2 or 3 hours where we can come out, and are completely rested and completely charged up our batteries, yeah, and have full strength of energy and concentration to tackle the things that the kilesas throw at us. Yeah, and they constantly throw things at us. See this. So difficult. I can't make it. Huh? Yes, when we see this, I can't do it. Huh? And then of course, our answer should be yes. Of course, you can't do it, but I can do it, because you, the kilesas, can't do anything. The only thing they can do is, it's so difficult, suggest, you should give up, you're not yet at that stage where you can, do this hard work. Of course you are at the stage where you can do this hard work, yeah? Every one of us, who comes to this monastery is at this stage, yeah? Everybody who is interested in this teaching can do it if he puts his mind to it, yeah? If he puts some effort and determination into it. You understand that? If you put your mind to it, yeah. If you put your effort and determination, you can do it. Yeah. When you read the suttas at the time of the monks at the time of the Lord Buddha, they didn't have an easy life. It was difficult for them. Yeah. You remember how he scolded them. Yeah. Huh? The Lord Buddha scolded his monks. Yeah. You remember that? Huh? But they had the opportunity to stay with the Lord Buddha. Huh? They had the opportunity. If they took it or not, that was up to them. They had the opportunity to learn something and to progress, yeah? In the way of, finding the way out of dukkha. Yeah? And that is completely up to us, you know, how much effort and how much determination we have. Of course, we have to build up a little bit of determination. We have to build up concentration. And that's why it is also important, you know, for us to, you know, to get and rest into the Supachara Samadhi, because that's where we find the strength and that's where we find also the conviction, yeah? There is something that I want, there is something that I was always lacking, and now I found it, yeah? And then when we come out, you know, we see we are in the same mess. So, what is the path that leads us out of this mess? Yeah, it is the investigation of these five khandhas, and we start with the investigation of the body. Because that's where most of our troubles start, yeah? I mean, hunger starts there, tiredness starts there, you know, I mean, all these unpleasant feelings of the body. Oh, I'm so tired, I can't walk anymore, yeah? Oh, I can't sit anymore because it's so painful. I mean, it seems to be the body that seems to be the biggest problem. That's why we have to investigate the body for what it is. There's the body, you know, it is a car, yeah? I mean, it is a comfortable car, it can do a lot of things, but it has, you know, just like any coin, you know, it has a head, you know, that is nice, and it has a tail, you know, that we don't want to see. And with the body, you know, we don't want to see the bad sides of it, that we constantly have to look after it. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't do anything for us. It doesn't give us any pleasure at all. Yeah. If you think, you know, it gives us pleasure, you know, I mean, before the pleasure of eating, you know, I mean, there must be hunger. Yeah. Without hunger, we don't eat. Yeah. So the pleasure of the body is getting rid of the unpleasantness of the body. Remember that? Huh? If there's no unpleasantness in the body, we don't need to get rid of it, yeah? But we feel so happy, you know, when we just ate something, yes, yeah? Oh, this is great food, you know, this is this, you know, oh, this is a great drink, and so on, and so on, and so on, yeah? But if there is no unpleasant feeling, all what we do, you know, when we're full, you know, when we eaten something or drank something, you know, I mean, then we are full. We are satisfied, you know, but it's not pleasure. We think of this, you know, satisfaction of the body being pleasure of the body, but actually it is not, you know, it's just that the dissatisfaction has disappeared. And that's what we call pleasure. That's a strange way, you know, of defining pleasure. Pleasure is actually when we are happy, you know, when we are satisfied, when we are completely, you know, when we are completely happy, completely contented. And the only time when we are really completely contented is when we rest ourselves in Upachara Samadhi, yeah? When there is no more thoughts and that create all these troubles, yeah? And when there is no more memories, you know, and when the past is not there and the future is not there, then we are contented, yeah? For the time being, yeah? And that's why, you know, and that's why when we come out, you know, I mean, it gives us some energy and then we know, the Lord Buddha taught us the way out, you know, sila, samadhi, panya. So, sila, yeah, I mean, keeping the five precepts. Samadhi is the training of samadhi or training of the development of sati, yeah. And panya is the investigation of the body and together with the bodily feelings. That's it, yeah. And that's the beginning. And it, you know, this investigation of the body and the bodily feelings takes us, yeah? If you remember correctly, takes us, you know, when we finish this investigation, takes us up to the stage of anagami, non-returner. Wow. We never come back in any, neither in the heavenly realm, nor in the hell realm, nor in the human realm. Huh? Wow, that is something, yeah? So we should strive for that, yeah? Or, yeah, at least, you know, we should strive for it, that to make an end of it, to enter the stream. But it also consists of body investigation, seeing that the body is not me. Yeah? Get out of the body, have a look at around the body, you know, go a little bit further, you know, see it from far away, you know, see it from closer, you know, go around, go to the back, you know, look at it, you know, and see, you are not the body. The citta and the body are two different things. And if you remember, you know, I mean, the citta is not within the five khandhas. Huh? The five khandhas is rupa, vedana, sanya, sankhana, vinyana. There is no citta. Huh? The citta is the occupier, or it is the owner of the body. Yeah? Or it is the owner. Yeah? You could say it is the owner of the khandhas, but that is not 100% correct. Yeah? But for the moment, you can say it like that. Yeah? It don't see things, yeah? And it uses it, yeah? Or you can say the five khandhas are the toolbox of the citta, yeah? It can create a lot of things with these five khandhas, yeah? But also can the kilesas create a lot of things, yeah? Because within the citta is, there's the Dhamma and there's the kilesas, yeah? And whoever sits on the throne, yeah, whoever has the command, yeah, I mean, uses this toolbox for its own, yeah, purpose. Yeah? And the kilesas normally use it for the purpose of playing around, yeah. Oh, let's do this, yeah. Oh, this is boring, yeah. Let's do something else. That is boring, let's do something else. Oh, I haven't been there, you know, let's go there. Oh, I want to become like this, or I want to become like that, yeah. And that's the kilesa is doing. And the Dhamma always says, let's go and sit down in meditation, yeah? Let's get happiness, let's get contentment, yeah? But the kilesas always find something, what I have to do, yeah? And when I look at you, I mean, you always have to do something, yeah? But this something that you have to do is not practice, huh? Strange, isn't it? Because the practice consists of two things. Sitting in samadhi or walking in samadhi or sitting in investigation and walking in investigation. That is the work that we have to do. And with this I close the talk, yeah. So, you have some questions?
Hey, I have a question. For body investigation, pain investigation, if we go to the point of pain, and then we stay with that point and really concentrate on it. But when I start asking questions, it's either I concentrate on the point or I ask questions. So I can stay with the area, or but it's multitasking, you know? I mean, I cannot concentrate fully on the point.
Of course, you know, investigation always involves thought. You know, that's not what, not 100% concentration. But the concentration, I mean, you when you read a book, you concentrate on the letters, yeah? Yeah. So, I mean, you concentrate on the point, you know, where the pain is, and then ask the question, you know. After asking the question, you watch, observe what is happening.
Yes, right. Go back and forth.
Yeah.
Yes,
that is why it is, why we get, you know, why we get so tired, you know, after a while of investigation. That's why we need to rest in samadhi, you know, to I mean, like everybody, you know, in the work, in the world, I mean, you went to work for 8 hours a day, you know, and you got tired, yeah? So you ate something and you slept, you know, in order, you know, to rest, yeah? And then the next day you started to work again, yeah? And that is the same thing with investigation. Of course it is tiring. That's why we need to rest in samadhi, yeah? After an hour of investigation, or sometimes, you know, when the rest is very good, after 3 hours of investigation, then you rest yourself in samadhi. Because it's a constant interaction. So you ask a question, then you observe what is happening, yeah? For instance, when you take the body and say, I want to see, you know, once you have the body in your inner vision, then you want to see, you know, how is this body dying, or what is happening when it's dead? And then you observe what is happening, yeah? Because the citta knows what is happening when the body dies. And then you see, you know, how the air goes out, you know, then you see how the fluid comes out, and then you see how it dries up, yeah? And then you see how it, you know, I mean, it's got get how it gets eaten up by all these, you know, worms that crawl out of the body that didn't crawl out of the earth, yeah? They were already there. Huh? Our own, you know, things, you know, that make the body decay are already, you know, we constantly feed it with every meal that we have, yeah? And then the moment, you know, they have the rain, you know, the body is dead, there's no more breath, and there's no mechanism, you know, to defend ourselves, you know, and then these things eat us up, yeah? And people always thought, you know, I mean, these worms, you know, come from the earth. Of course, there are animals that feed on the body, but they put them into, yeah, what is it called, zinc, you know, I mean, the zinc coffins, yeah, they were completely closed, you know, and they still were eaten up. Huh? With wood, you know, it's different, you know, because, I mean, then the worms from outside can crawl into, right? But they're still eaten up, yeah? And so what did they do, you know, I mean, in Egypt, you know? They took out all the intestines and everything, you know, that is dirty, that has these bacteria or these worms or whatever. They took it out so that it kept, yeah? that it wasn't eaten up. So you concentrate on the pain, and then you ask a question, and then you observe. Yeah, it's very interesting to observe that. You know, and you see. Yeah. And the rest, you know, I mean, everything falls apart, you know, and then you see the bones, and it takes a long time, you know. But even then, yeah, they, you know, will fall apart.
I don't really have the patience to look.
we don't want to, yes, that is something, you know, certain things we don't want to see. Yeah. Just bury it, or just burn it up. Yeah, I mean, but also look what is happening when you burn it up. Yeah, put it on a pile. Yeah, and then see, you know, the flames. You know, what are they consuming? You know, and then slowly see. You know, I mean, you can see it. You know, that it has known all sorts of death.
Then when it's hurting, you feel like
what?
Some things like this. Yes. Eating of Pac-Man is eating some stuff. And
what Pac-Man eating?
Pac-Man is a game.
Yeah, I know Pac-Man,
it's
yeah.
It's like we can eat fat or something.
But what is it eating up?
You can't see it, and it's like this nice, usually it's quite a nice feeling. I don't know how to say it.
Yeah, I mean, observe exactly what is happening, you know, what is eating what, yeah?
Is that eating?
Eating what?
It's like we're hungry and we eat and we get food.
Yeah. But, you know, what is this Pac-Man? Yeah, where is it coming from? Is it a thought? Is it a memory? Is it a feeling? And what came before this? I mean, I encourage you to think, you know, to reflect about what came before this, you know, before this Pac-Man comes. Yeah? I mean, it is a distraction, yeah? When you do investigation of and then suddenly something else happens, and then you go there, yeah? And, what is that? You know, I mean, you should stay, yeah? Samatha and vipassana are two different things. When I stay, you know, when I do vipassana, that means investigation, I stay with this point for 1 hour, yeah? I determine, okay, now, yeah? Except for samatha, when the pain comes up. Then I investigate the pain, yeah? Until the session is over. And then I stay with the pain. I don't go to the heart and see what is going on there. Huh? I mean, that is the kilesas. Look what is happening here. Oh, look what is happening there. Look what is happening there. I mean, that is our monkey mind. Huh? So, go back, you know. Okay, when you see a monkey mind, okay, pull it back. Pull it back. Pull it back. Just like in samatha. Pull it back. Pull it back. Pull it back. Okay. Any other question? Huh? Clear? Other question? Huh? No? Okay.